database, and we will do that. And then after that, I'll look at our application so that we see whether what we thought about the brain can actually be done in a teaching learning program. And then hopefully in the last hour or so, we can do further tests. I have with me Prof. Wanathir from also from the Center of Neurocognitive Sciences, and also my two my technicians, and also my master's PhD student who will do the test afterwards. So I mean, yeah, if you want to, we can do that for you. We'll give you the data later on. We'll keep everything anonymous. Yeah. So in terms of learning and with the brain in mind, what I would like to share with you is where we come from. And we actually come from this HitScan building here, known as the Center for Neurocognitive Sciences. It's just, if you please come to Kota Baru, you see us, we're just out in front of Science Kesehatan, beside the animal house. Yeah. So what we do is we work in fundamental sciences regarding the brain. We've got Prof. Rosli in as a co-researcher looking at neuroinformatics. We have neuroeducation, which is part of what we're doing today. We have community neurosciences, we also do neuroethics. Our researchers, well, we've got a whole lot of researchers, we all don't fit into that one building. That building just coordinates among our researchers that come, a lot of whom come from here, from the School of Education, from Architecture, from Sciences, from Computer Science as well. We hope that we can become the creative team of tomorrow. Now, when I came last time, I gave a talk and we said that this is a personal journey. I'd like to share with you a personal journey. Nothing much has changed since last time when I came, in that there's all these problems that are added on in addition to all the work we have to do and teach, and in addition to getting our KPIs. So it's quite tough, I think, to be a lecturer nowadays. There are a lot of challenges. And when I think about the challenges, what I think is that one of the challenges facing us are our end users. Yeah? And in terms of end users, we've got people that we term the digital fugitives. And I would say that the digital fugitives would be people like that, not in features, but in terms of thinking. Those who say that just give me a blackboard and talk and I can talk for 4 hours, and if the electricity goes off, I can still talk, but you can't with your iPads and iPhones, you know. So people like you and me, I think we are the digital immigrants. At least for me, I started off with, I know what is a typewriter. My children, I brought them to the museum in Kubang Kriat. They were surprised. There as well, you know, but we are the digital immigrants. It's something strange to us, but we have to live and we have to learn to use our computers, iPads and iPhones. On the other hand, the people we teach are the digital natives. Now, these are the people who know what to do. Your children know how to Google things better than we do. They know what to do when they're faced with an iPad. We have to go to Kursus to learn how to use this. You know? So, these are the challenges that we face. So between the three of those people, not only that, we also face the challenge of looking at our information literacy. Because I'm sure Prof. Tarek has mentioned a lot of time, we're looking at 21st century skills. We come from the 20th century, we have to look at 21st century skills. And a lot of things have changed since it was a blackboard kind of a lecture thing. So these are the issues that we face. We have to look at things that are collaborative, that are participative, that are evaluative, all right, when all we really want to do is give our talk and go home and lead our lives, you know. So it is kind of a big challenge. And also, the third challenge that I think we face is in the use of computers. Not that we don't know how to use computers, but the sheer power of those computers. You know, if you look at the book by Stephen Baker called The Final Jeopardy, they had a computer called Watson go against two other people playing the game, the top people playing Jeopardy. The computer won, of course. You know? So what does that tell you about education? Because what it tells you is something frightening, that the search engines are faster. You know, if they don't know anything, they'd rather Google than ask us, because they know that we know even less and that they can Google the information, rightly or wrongly, right? And the knowledge there, they can get it faster. They can get it more efficient than asking us, because we say, that's why I'm here. You find out and tell me tomorrow. You know, those things don't work anymore, unfortunately. unfortunately. So that's not the only thing that works against us. We also have digital media that is our problem. Things like the iPad that I'm using right now, looking at accessibility and ease of use. Students come to lectures with their iPads and iPhones and whatever. My husband loves to say it's iPad, iPhone, and for him it's iPad. So it's that kind of thing that makes it a problem. The quality, the accessibility, the ease of use, that poses a challenge to us in terms of how we teach and what we teach to whoever comes to listen to us. So, which means that eventually, isn't our role becoming devalued as a lecturer? You know, is it something that's happening, the devalued role? Because if you look at libraries, okay, in the Library Journal says that Brown University wants to eliminate state funding for California public schools. And you look at this is going on and on, and you have things like they want to close half of its branches. Nobody goes to the library. The librarians hate that when I tell them I've never been to a library for such a long time. It's not that I don't see or read journals, I don't go to the library. Right? So how relevant is that library? Same thing, how relevant are we as lecturers? You know, or are we going the way of dinosaurs? And what is our usefulness? And how user-friendly are we compared to Google, for example? Yeah. So these are the kind of things that we need to look at. And these, I think, are the major challenges that are facing us now as we look back and say, how can I become a better teacher? So, you know, this is the personal journey that I've been through. And then when I look at where we are, I would say that there are six new paradigms of change when we look at brain-based learning. Yeah? The first one would be the triad of teaching. I'll explain what that means later. The other thing is the concept of neuroplastic neurons, because I have to remain true to my profession. I always go back to the fundamental neurosciences, looking at our memories, the malleable memories, looking at genes and gender, looking at emotional experience, and at the end of it, looking at the ethics of it all. All right, can we ethically enhance our memories and our learning, and how good or how ethical is that? So those are the six paradigms that I will look at, at least in the first half of my lecture, of my talk this morning. All right, and when we look at that triad of learning, of teaching, it's actually ESP. It is engagement. And we all know, we have to engage, and we learn about this all the time. We need to use effective strategies, that is the S. And these are, to me, the P is there because we have to derive everything from the principles of neurosciences. I go back to evidence-based, and my evidence lies, for me, it lies in the neurosciences. So when we look at it in ESP, for me, what it means is that I need to take what I know about the brain, what people know about the brain, and then how we can combine those factors to excite the student's desire to learn, and more importantly perhaps, is to excite my desire to teach. After so long, you know, it takes a lot for us to wake up the next morning and say, same old lecture on blood pressure, how the heck do I make it fun for me, you know? So, and the other thing is to look at combining everything into an important cognitive tool. Now, when I did this slide, I realized the last bit there was out of sync. And I don't know about you, but it makes me uncomfortable. I'm a perfectionist, and I thought I had to go back and redo the slide. But I did not, because I thought I'll use, and it's not an excuse, because it demonstrates one important principle of brain-based learning, is that the mind is very organized, the mind likes to see things in order, but often the way we teach and what we do tends to be disordered, like my slide, you know? So that's why it's there. So the question is, how relevant are we, and can we really cope with this reality of being in the 21st century and given that responsibility to teach? Now this is a picture of a library in Basra. The book there says The Librarian of Basra. We actually managed to collect everything and preserve it, and they look like very pretty happy people in the library. But I don't know whether this is a reality for us and whether we can still retain our relevance. You know, perhaps our students will go to the library just to play and have fun. I think they do that right now. They have fun in a nice and quiet place. But how do we retain our relevance? How can we compete? I mean, I give up. I can't compete with Google. I can't compete with Amazon. I can't compete with all these sites. You know, my students, we tell them, take out your hand, keep your handphones. And I'm pretty sure while they listen to me, they can send an SMS with their thumb and still look at me and pay attention. I mean, that's fantastic. You know, I mean, that's a skill that we need to learn. But we need to attract them to our lecture. We need them to focus. And that's a major challenge. How do I cope with that reality? You know, perhaps it's more for me because I lived, as I said, typewriters we used before. When I did my PhD thesis, it was on a Commodore 64. That tells you how far back it goes. That had less memory, 64K. And when they ran up to 104.5K, it was like, wow, the memory doubled. So, I mean, that's how far back I go. All right, so that's the first one. Now, the second component that we're looking at is that the neuroplasticity of the neurons. And that's the central to the basis of the new kind of program that I'm doing that's brain-based. So when we talk about neuroplasticity, neuro being the nerves, plasticity being like plasticine, malleable. You have a certain volume of plasticine, you can shape that, you can change its shape. Well, just like that, our brains can change their shapes, right? So neuroplasticity is exactly what we're talking about because you see here, across the board, all the neurons are the exact same number, right? Except that the ones here have very few networks, the ones here have a greater network. The greater the network, the greater the connection, the faster the information, the more we retain, the more we learn, all right? So, I swiped the wrong link, okay. So if we look at neuroplasticity underlying the research that we do, basically what we're trying to say is that neuroplasticity is the brain's ability to reorganize itself. You know, when you walk in here and then you sit down now, if we could MRI, do a magnetic resonance imaging of your brain, the pathways actually have changed. And our brain 10 seconds ago, our brain 10 seconds after this, it's not going to be the same because of the stimulus we receive or not receive. All right? So that's neuroplasticity, and there are actually two ways in which that can occur inside our brain. We can either make new connections, all right, or we can actually delete connections. Or if we're bored, you know, it doesn't grow at all. You come in the same, you go out the same, you know, garbage in, garbage out, right? So it's that kind of a thing. And we hope that as teachers, the physical thing that we want is actually to make the brain grow. And to me, that's fantastic, yeah? Because actually, as a teacher, what we have in us is that ability to make other people's brains grow. No, isn't that fantastic? To me, it's a fantastic thing. If you just sit there, you talk about whatever it is it physics, anatomy, or whatever, you can actually make brains grow. On the other hand, you can actually make them decline and not grow. Yeah? That's also kind of frightening. So basically, it's like pruning a tree. Yeah? You can create new connections. At the same time, you can also remove connections. That's the basis of people having paraplegia, where they have a hypertension, and then they have a blood clot. They can regain some function. That's because we retrain the brain to grow connections elsewhere. Right? So that's the basis actually that underlies the philosophy of my teaching learning program that I will hope to show you after this. Because if you come from education, and I'm sorry, I do not know your backgrounds, but if you come from education, there are a lot of educational theories. I really don't know what they are. But they're actually based on behavioral psychology, they're based on studies of rats, looking at mazes. So it's really a mechanical kind of a model. But once you look at what's now, is that the study of the brain is now, it's about the neuroplastic brain. So the process is biological. It's more like the way it should be. That's how the brain learns. And so we have to teach to the way the brain learns. So that diagram over there, it's not a tree. It's a tree inside your brain. That's the dendrites from the nerves inside your brain. You know, and how many neurons do we have? I don't know who counted, but they say we've got more than 3 billion, so we have to believe them. But the nice thing they say is that we have, the number of neurons that we have in our brain is more than the number of stars in the entire universe. You know? So I thought that's a pretty beautiful thing to say, and scary. So your knowledge and seeing level actually increases, you know, with neural, what we call neural network growth. So if you spend a little time and a little effort, basically you get that kind of a ceiling level in terms of your knowledge. More time, more effort, more stimulus, you get a higher ceiling level. And then, you know, of course, you increase that, more time, even more effort, you get more linkage with other neurons. The number of neurons doesn't grow, it's the number of dendrites that do in most cases. Yeah? So the process is biological, and therefore when you talk about neuroplastic neurons, neurons, and you try to link that with our teaching learning, really we need to look at how we can combine things. Because brain-based learning needs to be experienced through lectures, through discussions, through e-learning, through reflection, the different things done together, because that's the way the brain learns. Now that diagram is a whole lot of adults in Tampa. I gave a talk and we gave them plaster seed to make little animals, and people actually learned from that. I thought, you know, these adults wouldn't do that, but actually we can actually learn through different ways. And from, we need to also create different kinds of learning environments. We need to be able to go not in one direction but in many different directions with using existing knowledge repositories. Okay, and just to share with you, all right, this is a picture of our center. It's maybe not so clear, known as Mindset. We set up one brain center episode where we wanted children to benefit from these kind of teaching learning methodologies that we try to put forward to teachers, right? Content and assessment. Well, content and assessment also needs to be separated. There has to be perhaps a lot of formative assessments rather than the summative assessments that we tend to get used to. And perhaps assessments should not be so rigid and so definitive and so determining your future, you know. Like, you don't go from here, you can't go to second year, you can't go to second year, you take the exam 3 years, three times, and that's it, get out of our university, you know, that kind of thing. So that's the second issue, yeah. The second issue being the neurons. The first one was about the triad of teaching. And the third one is memory. Now memory is something that's an issue, I think, to all of us, whether we're young or we're old. And because we receive the information, we organize it. We don't only organize that information, we alter it. You know, and that's a frightening bit. We alter it, and then we store, and then we retrieve. And often we alter depending on our background, our social cultural values, our emotion, and our feelings, all right, during that time. So memory is an active system, but it's hugely malleable. All right? It's hugely malleable, and it is something that involves us all the time. You know, you've got incoming memory. It could be what you see, what you hear, what you smell, what you touch, what you feel. All right. So all these things actually get into what we call sensory memory. You sense things from your environment, from what you hear, from the emotion around you. And then it has to be encoded. And all this is done through some biochemical things inside the brain. You need to encode this system. Once it's encoded, it goes into your short-term memory. Then your short-term memory, imagine all the steps, it goes into something called the working memory. Then from the working memory, it goes into retrieval and hopefully performance that is in parallel with the information that's coming in. Okay? But it doesn't stop there, because from your short-term storage, you need to consolidate. And that consolidation means you want to keep it. So that problem is, how is it from all that you come from here, how does it go into short-term, how do you keep that information? Yeah? And we'll see a bit later, it's not easy. Because then your long-term storage, not only do you keep that, because somewhere in that mind of yours, you've got to take it out again. Right? And then you put it back into your working memory, and then you have to retrieve it again. So you know, we have to be a bit more sympathetic to our students. They have to go through this entire system based on the lecture we give them, and that's something, you know, we have to salute them for that, giving them perhaps extra marks for actually going through that whole system. Because along the way, if you look at it, there's so many places that this thing can go wrong. You know? I mean, it can go wrong here because you fail to encode the memory. It can go wrong here because you don't know how to keep that system, that memory. It can go wrong here because you cannot retrieve your memory. You know, it can go wrong so many places. And that's frightening, you, either in terms of your ability to code, to consolidate, to store, more importantly, to retrieve. Alright, so these are the things that we have to be concerned about. Not only is that memory malleable and neuroplastic and changes, but we have problems trying to store that memory. Okay, and then when we look at memory, we have this whole pathway here. Alright, this whole thing here, and I know it's a bit too much there. We look at short-term first. Alright, so we look at short-term memory, and short-term memory is the sensory that we're talking about. And that sensory basically depends on two things: icon, images, iconic memory, and also what we call echoic memory, sound echoic memory. So these two things are mainly responsible for your short-term memory, mainly responsible for what you store, alright, and all that eventually goes into your brain, whether it's the frontal executive part, the part for you to learn, the part for your visual area, the part for sensory areas. It all goes in there, and that's your working memory. Now, the problem is that if you have this in your classroom or your classes, or hopefully not what I see here right now, I hope. I mean, like, well, this, you get this, and your short-term memory flies out the window. You know, it doesn't even have a chance in a million to even go into working memory or even go into your long-term. You know, so we need to get out of that kind of a paradigm. So I have a short game for us to do. If you can get up, you have a pen and a pencil. Alright, please, this is not an exam, there is no test, there's no number one, number two, and I don't have a prize as well. So what I want you to do is just, and I'm sure you're honest people. So what I would like you to do is just, for the next 20 seconds, do not write anything. Do not write anything. The next 20 seconds, please just look at this word list that I'm typing here. Yeah? Try to recall words. Okay? Try to remember that list. Alright, try to write down what you remember. Another 20 seconds. From number 1 to number 20 in the right order. Yes, in the right order. I didn't tell you before this, it's when the lecturers ever give proper instructions. Okay, so this is a graph that shows position, yeah? In terms of the percent correct here, and in terms of the word position over this side. Okay, and then if you look at the list, you have something known as a primacy effect. We have something called a recency effect. The primacy effect means, you know, what I told you first. So you probably can, if you look at your list, you probably remember cat, apple, ball, tree, and square. And recency, the last one that I mentioned, or the one that you looked at before, you probably remember shoe, key, and flower. You probably have difficulty in the middle bits. So that's a primacy and a recency effect. It has a whole lot to do with our teaching as well, you know. It depends what we come in to tell them in the beginning and what we tell them at the end. So, you know, if our salams to everyone finishes, takes 10 minutes, I mean, basically they remember only that. They remember our thank yous at the end, and then what the heck did Prof. Zalina say? I don't know, alright? Unless you look at that, there's this thing there, alright? That little peak there is interesting. I presume it was von Restoff who found out about that, because it's known as the von Restoff effect. And sometimes we can remember what's in the middle. And why we remember in the middle, some of us do association, yeah? Like we can say, we think about a house with a door that has a box inside, there's also a car, you know, weird things. And that hopefully lets you remember the bits in the middle. So, you know, if you, during your lecture, you show different things and it's not a monotonous dialogue, perhaps more peaks in terms of one rest of effect, and then they can remember a bit more. So really, it's an application. You know what I want to know. I know that you probably know this a lot from experience, but to me, it's nice to know that there is a biological and an objective reason for what we do, and the reason is because when we teach, we want to follow the way the brain thinks, the way the brain and the mind remembers things, because I think that would be the best way that we approach things, right? So that is in terms of the short-term memory that we were talking about, and then of course we need the short to go back into, to go into the long-term memory. And then when we look at long-term memory, there's a whole lot of differences. We've got our declarative memory, and then we've also got a non-declarative. Declarative meaning explicit as opposed to the implicit memory. I'll give you some examples, yeah? Like this, yeah? You remember, perhaps today you graduate very well. We might remember, you can even remember the smell, the sounds. You remember the day you were married, maybe the day you were divorced, maybe the day you had kids, I don't know. Alright, so that's a memory of events. That's really episodic, yeah? Specific personal experiences, particular place or time. Now this one, you know, we go through that all the time. I go through that all the time. I've got exams next month. I have that issue. Because it's just facts. I mean, it's a memory thing. You have to remember object knowledge, language knowledge. You have to remember that knowledge, right? So that's semantic. For facts, and then this one goes into non-declarative, non-associative learning. It is a form of habituation. I mean, you have to have that cigarette before breakfast, you have to have it after breakfast, you have to have it during your tea break. You know, it's things that you need to do. It's something that has become a habit. And then this one we all know, right? You set the alarm at 5. The bell rings at 5 o'clock, you wake up, you switch it off. I mean, that's the most correct thing to do, switch off the alarm to go back to sleep, right? So that's a classical conditioning response. I think, speaking from experience. So that, you know, that picture there either shows you a bottle jutting out of a truck, or it's actually just a flat picture. But it has to do with perceptions. Okay, and I'll talk about perceptions later, but really this is a perceptual representation system, and then we can see after this that perceptions can lie to us about certain things, right? And then of course this one here, like you drove here, I think when you drove here, you probably suddenly realize, my God, I already arrived. Or like you can think about something else while you're driving, hopefully not use your iPhone, but really that is procedural, it's skills, it's motto, it's cognitive skills. And you have been taught this again and again, it becomes second nature to you. So that's long-term memory. Eh? You've hopefully shifted it into long-term, now you actually put it into all those areas. Now what about teaching? When we teach, when students learn, what is it that we tell them about all these memories? What is it that we do best? What we do best is in terms of facts. We tell them what happened in the year 10, 11. We tell them what happened here and here and here. We tell them that the muscles of the upper arm, sorry, I'll just go back to what I had before. And it consists of this. And then they have to go and memorize. And then they come back. And then in the exam, we ask them the muscles of the upper arm consists of this. Very good. You know, facts, boring stuff. Yeah. And then, but we're good at that. We're also good at procedures. We teach them again and again. In schools, we have what, I just only knew this, that it's known as latihan to be. Yeah? Like, I thought it's like to be or not to be, but it's to be as in again and again. We train you again and again so that when you have the exam, you can just pout out the information. Okay? Right? So that's procedural, I suppose. Maybe we do a bit of perceptual training. We're good at conditioning. We're good at non-associative learning. We want you to make sure that everything in the book is second nature to you, so that in the exam, you can spout out those answers to me, and then I can have everyone getting CGPA 3.84, and then that makes my KPI look really good, you know? But really, we fail to do that. We fail to make it part of their learning. We fail to make it so, like, enjoyable to us. You know, just, I mean, I can't equate learning physiology with the first day of graduation or the day they got married. But, you know, it's something that makes it a specific personal experience. But if we look at the way e-learning is asynchronous, if we look at how we can personalize learning, we actually have now with us an opportunity to make that this thing here something that is very, very possible, all right? And make learning a lot of fun. Okay. So now this is a video I wanted to show that for reasons I can't show it now, but very quickly, I will show it after this, you know, if I have time. But really, you know, just now we showed you this picture about is the glass half empty or half full. Some of us say half empty, some say half full. I would say it is always full. You know, it's always full of water, half air. It's always full. It's a perception. It's the way you see things. It's basically how you make sense of your surroundings, yeah? But more of it later, if I can show you the video. I have technical problems with my iPad. Okay, so I think I still have technical problems with my iPad. If I can go to the next. Okay, now, this is how people teach about Newton's second law of motion. Big black dot, things like that. I don't know who learns about Newton's second law of motion, but I can tell you one thing about physics, yeah? I have been scarred for life because of the physics teachers. Seriously. What did I get for physics in Form 5 SPM? I got an A. You know? I surprised myself. Why did I get an A? Because I know I have to survive. I memorized everything. Do I know anything about physics? No. So I have a very, I think, a healthy disrespect about the way we teach people, because seriously, I get an A and I don't deserve that A. But I had to survive, right? So I think, you know, like in terms of teaching Newton's second law of motion, don't quite ask me what it is, but I think the best way would be to approach things perhaps, looking at David Beckham, you know, and telling people that, okay, what would happen, let's say, if the opposition gave him a ball that was heavier than what it was, and he tries to strike, and of course he can't because he uses a pressure that is not what he expects from the ball, right? Ball. So, or on the other hand, he has a normal ball, football, okay, and then he plays a trick, okay, he has extra power there, and suddenly he hits the ball in. So, you know, same thing, but a different way. Of course, it needs a lot of thinking on our part as to how we want to do this, but it's moving. So that's part number five, I think. So now we look at genes and gender. And this is interesting to me, because it has an implication on our education system, at least to me. Because if you look at the brain, and it's facing to the right, frontal lobe is in front, the occipital here at the back, and then down here is the brain stem, all right, further down. All right, now, the frontal lobe up here is decision-making, problem solving. It's proportionally larger in women. Okay? Not surprised. Women take forever to decide what clothes to wear in the morning. Decision making, problem solving. So it has to do, gender does play a role, right? Then you have this little bit here inside, deep inside your brain. It's a nuclei inside your brain. You can't really see it. It's a periaqueductal gray matter. It suppresses pain in men and women. And then if you say, like, you work in the emergency department or in an emergency ward, you can see there are differences, not just cultural, but differences in how males and females approach pain. You know, the men may be more stoic, the women can withstand pain, but not more than males. You know, we find males who get a cut on their hand and say this is the most painful thing they have, and you know, like, hello, they've never been through labor. So it's like a perception. But it has a physical basis. It has nothing to do with you being stronger or weaker. It's the way our brains are wired. You know? And then there's the amygdala. The amygdala down here is for emotional memory. And that's even interesting. It's proportionally larger in men. Now, and I go back to scenarios that I'm familiar with. Like if there is an accident on the road and two males pass by, they will stop to help. And they immediately take charge of the situation and say, okay, you can do this, you can do that, let's do this, let's do that. You have two females come by, and they stop, no, they do not become hysterical. No, we do not become hysterical, but we look, we assess, and then we say, now you do this, now you help me do that, and basically try to get people involved, you know, rather than taking charge myself and say, I'll do this, but let's all work together, you know, and do this maternal thing and help people around. So it's a difference. It's a difference because the pathways. Okay, so there's a difference between the male and the female brain. Alright? Now the hippocampus, it's known as the hippocampus because of its shape in the internal part of the brain that closely resembles a seahorse. Right? That's for memory, that's for spatial memory, proportionally larger in women, a cause of trouble between the male and the female brain. Alright? Because you have an anniversary, first wedding anniversary, 1 year from then, another one comes up and then she'll ask you, you remember the clothes we wore on that day? You remember the song we played? He says no. He just knows it's the anniversary, that's enough, right? Okay? But she wants to know whether you know what clothes I wore then, the perfume that was done and that I used then, you know, and then they get bored, you don't care about me anymore. And it's not that, it's just that women have an eye for detail, whereas men have an eye for some other issues related to memory. And it's nothing to do with male being better than female or the otherwise. It's only complementary to each other. Alright? And then same thing about the limbic cortex. The limbic cortex is proportionally larger in the female brain, meaning that females approach a kitten on the road and say, you poor little kitten, let me take care of you. And the male says, okay, just push it to the side of the road and let's get on with our lives, you know? So that's the limbic cortex. And then you have the parietal cortex. It has to do with space, perception of space. I think we all are familiar, I don't know about you, but the female, when they navigate the male driver will never stop for instructions and say, just go further ahead. You know, it's over here. No, you just go further ahead. Even with GPS, all right? We do that. So these are differences in terms of the brain. All right, now how does that affect teaching and learning? Does it affect teaching and learning? It does in a way, because there are quite a few structural differences. And what we have here is a picture done by the MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, where we can actually get a really accurate view of the brain, where we actually stick your head into this apparatus and we zap you with some changes in magnetic power, which is like 100,000 times the magnetic power, magnetic strength of the Earth's magnetic field. Then we realign all the molecules and then it goes back to normal. Very scary stuff, but we get this kind of a picture. Alright? And then we all know what's grey matter. We say you don't have grey matter, means there's something wrong with you. Well, men have 6.5 times grey matter related to intelligence. Nobody wants to clap?
Yes.
Alright, 6.5 times grey matter. What does that mean? It means that you can process information pretty well. Alright? Women, on the other hand, have 10 times of the white matter related to intelligence. We also want to clap. And that white matter really means we're pretty good at integrating memory, integrating information. Alright, but if you do both of these together and you look at the performance in terms of cognitive abilities, essentially, there is an equivalent performance. So what that really means is, the male brain and the female brain reaches the same conclusion, all right? But they take different pathways, all right, to get there. So that's the difference, yeah, that we have about the grey matter, the white matter, and really, if you don't mind, it doesn't really matter. But in a way, you know, you have your left brain, your right brain, and there is that thing connecting the two, known as the corpus callosum. Okay. All right, and the corpus callosum connects your left and right brain. Women have a lot more fibers in there than men, meaning that women can multitask. You know, you can sit down here and give a talk, and you can still in the back of your brain think, malam ni nak masak apa, siapa nak ambil anak, dan sebagainya. And the male brain does not do that. The male brain is very sequential. Not very sequential. And you actually have to remind the male brain, I have a lecture, can you pick me up today at 10, you know, at 1:30. So what it means is that if you have a meeting, you need both male and female brains there, otherwise nobody will come to a decision. All right. But you know, these sex differences, they lead to a lot of sex disparities as well. You look, I'm sorry about this, it's nothing to do with LCD, it's also blurry here. The male and female entry rates to university. I mean, that's New Zealand and Australia and the United States. It's the same with us. You know, every time there's an orientation, three-quarter female, one-quarter male. So there are these sex differences has led to several sex disparities in entry rates. And then you look at girls' literacy scores, they're ahead of boys who are age 15 in almost all major countries from Finland, New Zealand, Poland, Australia, etc., and even Indonesia. Right? So women, females tend to do better in school. Because of that, they do better in their entry exams, and because of that, they are the ones who enter university. Right? So these are the differences that lead to sex disparities, and people, you know, people want to know why does that really happen? You know, why does that really happen? And then you look here, yeah, in terms of educational disability, it tends to be more in males. Learning disability, emotional differences, speech impairment, mental retardation. Boy, males have it bad. I think. But, you know, all right, but why? Where does it happen? So congratulations to all males here. You really did very well. No, really, seriously, why does it happen? Yeah. Because, you know, as a fetus, right? The male fetus has a lot more of the gray matter. We just said that males have more of the cells than the females. So if there is anything that affects the mother at that time, whether it is a toxicity, whether it is, I don't know, whatever she took or whatever air she breathed, it's going to affect the neurons in the males more than in the females. Because the males have more neurons, and these toxins are more effective, more selective on the neurons itself. So males tend to lose these neurons compared to females who don't have much to lose in the first place. So therefore, as they grow older, they get higher losses of neurons, which explains why a lot of these disabilities are there in males. You know, it has to do with the structural relationships. Now, how does that affect us in education? It affects us because we have something known as the feminization of education. It's something that should worry all of us. When we go to schools, yeah, what are the role models? What, 3/4, 78% of teachers in primary schools are females. Even in male schools, right? In universities, the lecturers are female more than males, the students are females more than males. So the male never gets this male perspective of things. You get to schools and the teacher will say, read page this and this, and take nota from, they're big on taking notas, yeah, from this page to that page. The female brain can take it just fine, the male brain cannot. The male brain wants to have a 10-minute break so they can go out and climb trees and play outside. What's wrong with us changing the way we teach to fit the male brain? Not asking the male brain to fit the way we teach. And that, I think, is the unfairness of what we're doing. It's nothing to do with the brain. It's got nothing to do, I think, with being male, but it has everything to do with the way we approach how we teach them. And I think that's a lot of it is our fault. I think we need to look at how the male brain thinks and then gear our teaching accordingly, how the female brain thinks, and gear our teaching accordingly. So the feminization of education is one of the things that researchers at BRAINetwork are also looking at. It's something that worries us, because when we look at the data also, we don't just have the feminization of education, we're also having the feminization, the physical feminization of the males. Right? And that has become a big problem, and they're wondering why. Aside from education, it has to do with the water. Now seriously, are people saying the water? Yes, the water. Because right now, if you do pharmacology, you'll find that because of the excessive amount of estrogens being taken, because of the excessive amounts of people taking contraceptives or whatever, there's a high level of female hormones, estrogens circulating in the water that you drink. You know? That is a cause of worry. Solution, don't drink water, I don't think so. But we have a big problem here. We have to address the issue. It is a major issue. Yeah? So that's the implication we have. So if you're interested to know, yeah, you notice I talk about the female-male brain. I don't talk about man's brain or a woman's brain. Because your sex, your brain sex can change. No, seriously, your brain sex can change depending on the situation. So you can go to that website. I can think it's available afterwards. But at that website, there's a questionnaire that you can take, an online questionnaire, to find out whether you have a male brain or a female brain. And then you can take it later on, and depending on the situation, your brain will be a bit more male, a little less female, etc. You know, it has nothing to do with your physical gender, but it has everything to do with the way your brain is wired at that time. So you can go here, and you can find out more about what your brain sex is, your brain gender. But that's an interesting and a very revealing thing to do. You know, because how many of us know what our intelligence is, what our profiles are, how we think? We don't know much. You know, and we do have a few tests after this. If you're interested, we'll do one or two tests. And if you're interested later on, you can, you're always welcome, and we can do a full profile for you as to what your brain actually looks like in terms of physical as well as the mind itself. Right? Now, I don't know how many people have seen this picture. Alright? Is the color above and the color below the same? If you have seen it, your answer would be yes. And of course, if I ask that question, obviously the answer is yes, it's the same. Alright? But we look at this and we see the up there is almost, it's a dark gray, and down here it's white. Alright? This is not a trick that I'm doing with PowerPoint, but it's the same color as that rectangle over there. So that if you take that rectangle and put it to the top part, it merges. Alright? Now, same thing. Alright? Now, same thing again. If you take that same colored rectangle out, alright, and move it down to that the structure below, it also merges. Alright? It also merges because it is the same color. I tell you it's the same color. You know from what I'm telling you it's the same color, but you and I see it as different colors. Now, what if we add this? You know, we plot the center part, okay? And you see that it is the same color, right? What made it different, all right? This is what we saw, okay? Then we, what we saw, and then this is what we did after that, okay? Why is it that here we see two different colors? It's because your brain tells you about the shadows. The brain takes in the things about the background. The brain takes in other cues. And these are the cues that tells your brain that they are two different things, even though we all know it is not. I mean, you and I know it is not. Okay? It is the same color. But if we look at it, knowing that, it is still not the same. Alright, and that has a huge implication to me in terms of what we teach and how we learn. Because we may be telling things to students, we may be telling people about perceptions, right? But, you know, what we learn is all based on previous knowledge, it's all based on experience. There are some things, no matter what people tell me, I'm not going to believe them, even if they're right. I mean, we're wired that way. And this is a classic example, you know. It is the same color, but you still see it differently, you know? And that's what makes me so interested in the brain, you know? And there's another one here. Maybe you've seen this. This is the stroke test. And you need to look at the chart, and you need to say from left to right, okay, or right to left, the colors, okay? You have to say the color and not the word. Meaning you don't say yellow, blue, orange, black, red, green. I want you to say green, red, blue, yellow, blue, black. Can you do that?
Slower.
Right. It is slower, right? It is slower. Now the interesting thing is we've tried this on children in primary schools, children in Tanika, and they don't have as much problem as we do. They're able to do that pretty fast. Now we have a problem. It's a left brain, right brain conflict. We didn't dwell into what is the left and the right brain. The left brain is more logical. The right brain tends to be where the centers for creativity are. Children in primary school, children who are not yet in school, they have not been corrupted yet by the entire education system in primary school. Okay, they are creative. So they can say this no problem. By the time you get into primary school, by the time you get into Form 1, you will have major problems trying to do this. It is a left brain, right brain conflict. Your right brain wants to be creative and say the color. Your left brain is logical, you know, and our our world, the world that we introduce to our students, it's a logical world. We forget the creativity, they come to university, they tell them you have to be more creative. But this demonstrates that very clearly. The other thing that demonstrates this is that if I ask you here how many people think that they are geniuses that can change the world, can you put up your hands? Nobody? Alright, how about just a genius that doesn't change the world? Clever, bright, intelligent. You ask that same question, yeah, to people in Tanika. Saya cikgu. What has happened? It has to do again with this. Creativity, the ability, the self-esteem, you know, to say that yes, I am an expert in my area and I'm really good at what I do, you know, but nobody does that anymore because we sucked out the creativity from them the minute they go into school. You know, and we need to learn and change these things. Okay, so the lessons learned so far is that attention affects memory during the encoding phase. And that attention is important, that if you do a parallel task, you can impair the success of it. So, you know, that's why sometimes it was difficult for you to remember those words because of the context. You were here looking at the lecture, not sure what to do next, you know, and it's outside maybe the areas you're comfortable with. So attention is something that may affect learning. So with motivation, positive, negative motivation, it reinforces learning. They both can motivate, but negative motivation doesn't mean you can't learn. You do learn. It's just not pleasurable, I presume. Interference, the last few words in the that you remember because of the recency effect and the primacy effect, but you can displace these things very well. It is said that you remember everything in a lecture, but after 45 minutes, you take a toilet break, you forget most of what was mentioned. So no toilet breaks. And then context, yeah. So we recall more when the environment is similar. That's why we want to encourage students to learn in the same context, you know, as how they use their knowledge situation. If it is the music, they can recall more perhaps if that's what they want to do. So the situation is important, and so is gender, because female perform better than males on episodic memory, including delayed recall and recognition. Males and females do not necessarily differ on working and immediate and semantic memory, okay? But delayed recall, females do better. A lot of our exams are delayed recall. Females do better. Not fair. And of course, females recall mistakes better than males. We remember. Like the proverbial thing. All right. And it has to do with our brain. Don't blame us. Brain the thing. So, you know, Christopher Reeve, the first Superman who has passed away, he says if you choose hope, everything's possible. And that's why we have all these, all of these motivational talks to give to children. We tell them you need to have this hope that in future you'll be the one that will change the world, etc. Now, how effective is that in learning? Does it have a basis, you know, in some objective change? And I would like to say that yes, it can, because the fifth one is that if you choose hope, that is positive expectancy. It actually increases certain chemicals in your brain. All right, it increases your mood. It increases your ability to improve results. So that people say that even if you do everything else right, if that student doesn't believe in you, if you have lowered their self-esteem, then you would have failed. All right, and the two hormones. The two substances that are important to us are adrenaline and dopamine. Right? We'll come back to that later. And to me, yes, they need hope, but that hope is not that something to motivate them. That hope is based on the real science of physical change. It is a science of physical change. You actually increase the amount of adrenaline and dopamine. All right? Now, I have to remain true to my background. There is something known as the general adaptation syndrome. I will talk to you about that. But basically, if there is stress, yeah, and this is the ability for us to withstand stress, and basically the response would be that there is a phase where the blue one, in phase one, we are able to adapt to it. Number two, if there's a stress, we can compensate, you know, and then come back to normal. And then in the third stage, perhaps we may have resistance, but then we have problems, and eventually we just cannot cope with the stress, right? So we would like our students and ourselves, especially, to be at that level A, all right? And but sometimes we have to compensate for our stress. Sometimes there's a lot of resistance, and then we have a lot of problems, hypertension. I think some people do have hypertension, diabetes, diseases of lifestyle, and then we end up like that, our students end up like that as well. So we do not want that. We want ourselves to be perhaps in this zone. But if our teaching is an experience that is non-conducive, we do end up with a lot of physical and emotional problems. And a lot of this has to do with this, the axis here from the hypothalamus, which is just behind your eyes, down to the anterior pituitary, the base of the skull, down to your adrenal cortex. Adrenal means ad, renal means your kidneys, right? So add your kidneys. And what that happens is that you secrete endorphins. Now, endorphins are interesting. You can actually make yourself secrete endorphins. And endorphins is the body's morphine, right? It's the body's morphine. You actually generate your own morphine. And actually, if you are in labor, well, half of us will get into labor, you can actually not use anesthetics. You can actually get yourself to generate enough endorphins not to feel pain. You know? And that's the basis of acupuncture. Let's take a needle in your big toe, and then they can do a big operation. We really don't know why. It's working for a lot of research. But seriously, one of the things we do, we are able to generate endorphins. Now, isn't that the beauty part of the brain? You know, you talk, you give your lecture, you change the brain. You can actually make your brain secrete the endorphins. I mean, we have that. We have so much power in us to change the brain. And then, of course, we secrete cortisol, which is stress hormone, and adrenaline. It's also from the adrenal gland on top of the kidney. That's important because when you have an exam, when you're studying, you need an increase in heart rate so that there's more blood volume, there's more respiration, there's more oxygen to the brain. Pupils dilate, I think perhaps so that you see a bit more. Hopefully your digestion decreases at that time, your muscles contract, your blood pressure increases, you learn. On the other hand, if you're in section E, this is the same thing that's going to make you hypertensive, that's going to make you diabetic, that's going to eventually kill you. So this is the emotional experience related to learning, and in a way, we are responsible to make sure that our students have a pleasurable experience so that they do not go from phase one right down to the decompensation phase of phase two. Now, the final one that I want to look at before we stop for tea break, and it's interesting, the word final always gives hope to people. The final one is something known as, the research that we're doing in our lab, is something called the brain-derived neurotrophic factor, BDNF. Now, BDNF is needed for neurogenesis, to grow your pathways, to give you more neurons. How do we get BDNF? Is there a tablet you can take? Is there a fruit you can eat? Is there a magic potion that I can sell to you? I wish I could. Yeah? I don't think I have anything that I can sell to you, because BDNF is something that you and I can make all the time very easily by just simple exercise. Simple exercise. You know, it has been shown that if you run, if you do physical exercise, and we do that with our abs, and it has also shown it in MRI, that you run, you do physical exercise, you actually increase BDNF. And when you increase BDNF, you increase the amount of the pathways, and you can actually learn faster and better. The bad news is, once you increase and you don't exercise, it drops down again. So it's not something forever kind of thing, but it's something that you need to maintain, and you don't need any money, anything, except, I guess, the willpower to run around USN. So regular exercise actually charges your brain. It stimulates the parts of the brain associated with memory and memory. Right? So this is something that we are looking at right now, at least in terms of the fundamental neurosciences. Yeah? So that brings us to the other issue. Is there a drug that I could sell? You could actually buy this online. You know, it's Vitalik. Okay, and Ritalin is said that, it says here that Ritalin abuse among students occurs so much so that they can perform very well. You know, they don't have immediate side effects. Their learning and memory improves when they take Ritalin, and people give this as a form, as a routine drug to their children, right? Because they want the children to perform well. There's a, it boosts alertness. Your academic work is done faster. It improves concentration. Maybe I need some. All right, and there is also another drug called modafinil. Modafinil stops you from falling asleep. It enhances your brain power. It allows you to remember things. There are no immediate side effects. Is it wrong then to take modafinil and Ritalin? I can buy that on the internet. You can send it to me by courier to the lab, you know, and you can use it. Is it wrong? Is it wrong? So when we talk about education, these are issues that will come up. These are issues that we need to look at, because you might end up taking it yourself or your children or the people who come to you. Now, how fair then is your exam if somebody with Ritalin passes it and somebody who doesn't buy the Ritalin does not? And that people who pass are measured only by their ability to purchase things, right? So the use of psychoactive medications by normal people to enhance, all right, to enhance neuro enhancement, how ethical would that be? I don't have the answers. But the neuroethics component of the research that we are doing right now, these are the, some of the issues that we are looking at in terms of the different ethics, the ethical approaches, right? Because Ritalin gives you greater vigilance, fullness, all right? And people say, look, it's all right, because it can normalize, it can normal after this, what's wrong? Okay? I don't have answers, because there is potential harm. We haven't looked at the side effects. You, to me, I think you promote greater inequality and you change that perception. Oh, I must be a genius. I'm not a genius, I just took modafinil, for example, all the time. Is it now the kind of assessments we use in the face of these kind of things that I can so easily buy right now? You know, you have a computer with you, you have your iPad, you have your pad. So what's the difference between treating a disease and enhancing the human brain? This is a subject of what we call cosmetic neuropharmacology, and it is a major, major ethical issue that we have to face. And I don't have answers for that matter. I just would like to share with you a bit about the project that we did based on the learning methodologies that I mentioned earlier. It's known as Project Impact. Innovative methods in physiology and anatomy during the transformation. And if you don't mind, so this is what we call 20th century learning. We have a core subject and then we have an assessment. And that's pretty much what it is, where we emphasize the memorizing of facts and information, and then we hopefully spit that out. They do not really need to understand and make sense of the data. But right now we are saying we have to go beyond 20th century learning, and we need more towards generating not useful and applicable knowledge. So I think you're familiar with this diagram, and I do not really need to go through it much. But that's what 21st century learning is all about. Looking at core subjects beyond minimum mastery, looking at perhaps emotional and social connections to skills, looking at interpersonal collaborative skills, and then ability for us to use technology that can support 21st century teaching and learning. Our students do that better than we do. Looking at thinking and reasoning, information and communication, and then even our assessment needs has to change in the light of the kind of teaching that we do, a tall order that we have to do in the short time that they give to us. But we really need to look at 21st century learning. Our Prof. Karim is very big on 21st century learning. And essentially, I come from the 20th century, and that's the kind of world that I come from. And when we say 21st century, really, we're looking at it being exact opposite in a way. About it being learner-centered and more of a collaborative kind of system that looks at knowledge but also emphasizes the skills that looks at process rather than just content alone. And of course, we need to look at higher order thinking, a big thing, whatever it means in our context. Of course, we look at practice rather than just theory alone. Life skills is important, not just the curriculum. We want our students to work in groups rather than just individuals, and that hopefully they can go outside the classroom and work within their community as well as the community at large. And then even the way we look at assessments changes, because we don't just go for the big high-stakes summative assessments. We want to look at formative evaluations, and then hopefully the learning is for life, so that in the end, when we say 21st century, we want to strike a better balance. A tall order for us, and how do we look at this given the context of the brain, and how the brain thinks and how the brain learns. So we attempted that, and to try and look at why 21st century skills are important. Now, why am I showing you this? It seems to be a bit out of topic, but this is at Pulau Banding. This is the Pulau Banding Foundation from MK Holdings. This is Tasmi Mustafa Kamal. There was a symposium we attended as BRAINetwork. One of the things we do, we do community-based work with the Orang Asli. And this is where we work with also the School of Biology that looks at the biological fauna. We look at the human ecosystem. We want to come up with a sustainable eco-village, a tall order, but we're looking at the education there as well. What attracted me there, why it is relevant here, is the keynote address by Tan Sri Mustafa Kamal, where he threw a challenge which I felt that I may not be able to answer him, because he says, what the heck are universities doing? He says, we interviewed, he says, 300 people with bachelor's, master's, PhDs. I only took four of them. You know, like, this is something we hear all along. He says, what are you doing in the university? What are you trying to produce? Because none of them can string two sentences together to make sense, whether it is in English or in Malay. And I thought, yeah, that's pretty true. He also, interestingly enough, at that time, held up our symposium book, which had all those writings in there, and he says that this is going to be rubbish. You know, all your papers, all the things that go into journals, he says, this is pretty much rubbish if you cannot translate it into something tangible that benefits the community. So that really strikes deep into the heart of us being academicians, right? We write in journals, and I feel that we are very guilty also at looking at things, but perhaps not emphasizing 21st century skills. So in a way, that's why it's there, it's our topic and yet it's not. So the kind of conditions that we can control and alter to improve student achievement. When we sat back as a group, we were wondering, what is it that we can do? And that's how Project Impact came into being, because we said that at least within what we are capable of, we can change the what, the how, the where, and the who we teach, right? The characteristics of the students, the effectiveness of the schools, the quality of our instruction, the curriculum, somewhere around within those four things are something that's at least within our control that we could change. So those are the things that we wanted to look at. And out of that was born the need for this concept of collaboration, creating, connecting, and communicating our learning. And from there, we had Project Impact. We looked at physiology and anatomy. We're looking at innovative methods in physiology and anatomy curriculum development. That's where the word impact comes from. So this is what we did at the School of Health Sciences for the first year, because everybody came into the School of Health Sciences and said that anatomy and physiology were the killer subjects. I mean, they don't do well there. You know? So how can we look at it? We wanted to look at the way we change. Because previously we had lectures, tutorial, and maybe some feedback sessions. So we had, you know, the usual workshops, then we had our lecturers were involved, some of the students were also involved in looking at structure and function. We implemented it in 2012-2013, and we're also implementing it this year. And we focus on three areas. Now, can we look at active learning and an interactive online presence, and how can we help our students to succeed? So in terms of active learning, these were the three things that we thought we had to put into our project, and how do we do that? And then when we said an online learning presence, we also wanted to look at these three issues that it had to be done by the students and for the students. It had to be available in an asynchronous manner, and that also gets our administration quite worked up, because we say, when are they going to study? Whenever they want. So it doesn't work. I want a timetable. You have to factor in the timetable. So we put in a timetable, we told the students, you don't have to follow, right? So we help the students to succeed. We say, okay, can we give them some kind of tools? Can we give them some effective note-taking methods? And can we use something we call an examination analysis? We say, we give you the tools, you learn, you do it your way, right? The dean allowed us to do this at least for 1 year. And then, based on that, you know, what we had were what we termed the four C's of our project. The first one was in terms of the content, right? And when we looked at the content of what we taught, you know, structure and function, you either know the structure or you don't, you either know the functions or you don't. But we wanted them to collaborate through interactivity. So Project Impact, you know, had some nice logo there, started off with a lot of interactive lectures. This was also difficult for the lecturers. We said no lecture should last more than 30 minutes, of which like 20 minutes is a lecture, and then we have interactive sessions, right? And we did that for structure with interactive lab sessions and also collaborative quizzes, same thing for function, where the students also gave the lectures and we had quizzes. Now, lecturers were up in arms and say that we have enough of quiz. We have to start give the questions, we have to mark the questions. We say, when we say collaborative, in the lab, the students set up the station, the students set up the questions, they all go on one round and answer the questions. Basically, they set the questions and they mark themselves, and we just sit down, just quite a good thing to do, you know. So that was the formative kind of assessments that we did. And along the way, the student evaluation after that had a summative assessment, and we had a feedback, which we're still analyzing, but we find that the students found that very interesting. Now, the e-learning was not factored in at all. They say, you can do it, you don't want to do it, that's fine. You want to come to the lecture, you can. If you don't want, that's fine. And then the administration says, but they have to come to the lecture. If they don't attend, I don't know how to send it, then they can't sit for the exam. All right, we will sign it for you. You don't have to come if you don't want, okay? Because we don't want them to come for the lecture. But students being students, they came to the lectures. But really, what we're looking for was content that was transmitted to different levels of collaboration, through different interactivity between the students and the lecturers that were involved. Basically, this was our important aim. And the lecturers that were involved were those teaching anatomy and physiology. So that was the collaboration through an interactivity. And then when we looked at the curriculum, we didn't want to change anything to do with the curriculum, because that, you know how that is going to come down if we say we want to teach less, alright, or we want to teach more, it's okay, less is not, alright. So we say we need to connect to the differences, not the similarities. What we are teaching right now is a one size fits all, and you know anything that's free size doesn't fit everyone. Right? But we need to get something that connected to the differences, not the similarities. How many students do we teach for physiology and anatomy? This is a compulsory for everyone who attends first year. We have 220 students to teach. So we said that not all the learning had to be online. We have to mix it up, you know, with interactive lectures and discussions. And similar to what we saw earlier, we created a kind of an informal learning environment. For the students, we use Moodle for that. And then we separate the content and assessment. We had a lot of summative assessments that were student-led, formative, and then we had also summative assessments. In addition, well, you know that page, that's a very familiar Moodle kind of page. And what we did was we had to rely a lot on the online learning management system that we had. And we were very happy with this because we could actually profile the students very well from there. But we knew that a lot of students did not actually want to go there. So we also had Twitter, we also had Facebook, we also had the kinds of social media that the students were familiar with rather than the lecturers. We actually had to have a crash course for the lecturers to learn how to use their hashtags and how to use Twitter. Facebook, everyone's familiar with. We also had administrative issues because I don't know about here, but in Guangdian, they did not allow people to use Facebook. You know, and we say we want Facebook, we want YouTube for teaching. They are not allowed to use YouTube as well. So we had to get special permission for that. So then when we looked at the kind of learning modules that we had different kinds of learning resources. We had the virtual laboratory. There were feedback, different kinds of feedback, different types of learning modules, so that we catered for the different learning styles, right, of the students. And then we also had a lot of feedback and questionnaires early on, because we wanted the students and also the lecturers to find out what was the way they learned, what kind of brain did they have, was it a left or a right brain, how did they learn best. And then we told them, based on what you, the way you learn, these are the things that you could use to learn anatomy and physiology. Maybe you do not need to come and listen to a lecture, for example, only. Or on the other hand, student B might benefit more from a lecture rather than an audio feedback from a podcast, for example. Right? So we evaluated the profiles and we gave them back their own profile that they could use so that they could understand how they learn. So this is how we attempted to connect to the differences, not the similarities. Because we had 200 students, and we could not individually look at one student, it's impossible. But because of the technology that we have, we can very easily look at everyone in a different context. You can actually individualize, even if you have 100 or 200 students. And it might seem a lot of work in the beginning, but eventually, you know, it pays out in terms of once you have everything in place. We had to look at ourselves and say that we wanted to look at creating knowledge, and we needed the students to learn how to learn, right? And then we came up with three different types of tools, and they had this opportunity to experience all three tools with the various activities. What kind of tools did we have? We had tools that promoted active learning, whether it was through the lectures or the small group and small group sessions, the collaborative quizzes. We had tools that allowed them to look at and maintain an active online presence. We're still looking at the results, but we find that although we thought that our students are very savvy on the internet, their savviness extended to Twitter and Facebook, but really when it comes to really using peer-led learning and asynchronous learning, it was difficult for them, especially in the beginning. You know, they come from like years of school, you know, where they come and then they actually at that time, you know, they have cikgu nak belajar buku mana, you know, they come in the very first day. And now we're telling them, read whatever book you want. You should see their faces like, oh my god, why am I at USM Medical Health School? That lecturer doesn't even know which book. And we tell her, you don't have to come to the lecture. These are actually major things for them. Not come for the lecture, how will I learn? Not come and listen to something, no notes, how will I learn? But to their credit, they actually did help us out in here. And we gave them some tools, they were guided in a way, yeah, they were left on their own, and it was an experiment for us, so we were scared as well, because if they don't do well, you know what's going to happen the next time they have a school board meeting, right? So we were kind of worried. So you know, this is a word that's bandied around all the time. We have lectures talking to us about constructivism and things like that, words that are kind of alien to me, because I don't come from an educational background. But basically, from my understanding, what we needed to do was to encourage them not just how to learn, but perhaps to construct their own knowledge. And what we needed to do was to provide a collaborative learning environment, and in the process, make them an active participant. That's what we were trying to do. In one semester, could we take them away from the concept of a lecture and learning on their own independently, and could we give them an active participation? So what we did was, in looking at this issue, we also had another three things that we did. We had the inquiry-based learning pathway. we had a problem-based learning pathway. They were given problems that they had to solve, and you know, the medical school is big on problem-based learning, so we could learn from how they did that. But we also, interestingly, had a project-based learning. We essentially gave them something to do, and then we left them on their own, and then we looked at how, at the group dynamics, and how at the end of the day, they were able to come up with solving the project. You know, they had a day where they presented it to us. So along the way, what we had as basic or central to our project was a universal design for learning, where there were multiple means of representation, and that was through the inquiry-based learning. The problem-based learning allowed for the multiple means of expression, and then through the project-based learning, we were able to look at multiple means of engagement, the three requirements that come under this universal design for learning that we were interested in. So very quickly, the education model that we were looking at has that universal design. It did not run away from the neural networks because perhaps in another lecture or something we could look at, they're actually very five, they're five very specific networks that we were going to stimulate in terms of what we teach. And then we looked at their different intelligences, their profile. And based on that, right, that's a center to our education model, and we could facilitate the knowledge in terms of their understanding the core knowledge and strong fundamentals, and that was our interactive lecture. We look at application, and that was through the e-learning modules, that was where we looked at application. We challenged them in the sense that we had a research-based component that was there in the projects, but also some research that they had to do. I'll show you what I mean in a minute. And in terms of diversity, we wanted to support a variety of student needs. And so it was community-based in the sense that it was the student community of learning as well as how the students interacted with the outside community. So this is the education model of Project Impact. And it is based on strong evidence, right? So we had a scientific basis for that evidence. There is neuroplasticity because we look at different ways of learning, and that would build up on the neurons. We use a lot of instructional technology that would allow for them to weigh the different information they had. The process of learning, because it was asynchronous, that's perhaps how the brain learns. It is participatory. If there is a lot that is informal, and more important for us, we let the students take control of their learning. And in the beginning, there was resistance from the students, there was also resistance from the lecturers. Both sides were saying, can we allow the students to do this? Especially in what they thought was a killer subject, anatomy and physiology. So we were literally like jumping off on the deep end to see, and hopefully we didn't drown. Since we're here, I think we didn't. Alright, so what did we do actually? What did we do? We had an introduction where we told them, this is how we're going to experiment with you for this 1 year, and you should have seen their faces experiment with us, but if we fail, you know. So this is the, we had an introduction, sorry. And then after that, we told them that this is one pathway of interactive lectures, and it's a large group, 200 people there, you know, with interactivity. And then, if they wanted this pathway, fine, from there, they could go straight to the end of semester exam, no problem. The normal way we do things. All right, but we told them that if you are interested, you do not need to do this, or you may go from here to the asynchronous learning. All right, we have the modules, we have the assessments there, there's a forum where you can go, there are social networks embedded into that e-learning module that we have. And then from there we say, okay, you can go to the summative assessment if you want. You can take that pathway if you want. And it was interesting to note that a lot of people, everyone took pathway number one, I think it's a sense of security. And a lot more went to pathway number two. Some people didn't. You know, some people were just saying, I want to pass, and the only way I'm going to pass, forget all these wonderful things they think they're doing. I just want to pass in the sense, you know. So they just took pathway one. Then we told them as well that if you're interested, we give you small projects, small brain-based projects. You can interact with the postgraduate students in BrainetWork. We have your online modules, and then we send you to present your data at a conference. and then, you know, you learn more about physiology. We had, I think, two students, I'm not sure, who actually did this, who presented at the conference, and who actually took this with, right? We also had about 12 or 14 people who said they wanted to do their learning through a community-based program. And they worked with us on exhibitions. They worked with us with the Orang Asli community. And in a way, they looked at how you could translate the structure and function into practice. So we were happy that we had actually 12 volunteers who were willing to do this. And that was the fourth pathway. And at the end of the day, everyone took the summative assessment. So they took the summative assessment in the first semester. They did. We did the same thing in the second semester. And at the end of the day, although the results are not here, and you have to believe me when I say this, they really did well. They did very well in the exams. We have the data, we should show it to you, you know. But we were all very happy as lecturers that it worked. It was a gamble, but the students liked it very much. Right? So that was the third one, that by their research, by their community work, by their e-learning, they actually managed to create the knowledge in a different perspective, and they managed to learn how actually to start learning for the next phase. Because in the first year, they all had the structure and function, and then in the second year, they all now branch into biomedicine, into forensics, into nursing, etc., where they needed this kind of information. And we wanted to make it as easy as possible for them. So the fourth one was active participation. That was difficult to get in the beginning, but because of the nature of the structure, you know, of the structure of the program itself, because of the interactive lectures, the presence of moderators during discussions, because of the, they were supposed to come up with a project, because they had to have make their own questions during the summative and the formative assessments, okay, there was a high level of communication and facilitation. So, but we did have some issues, yeah? There is a myth. The myth is that it's easy to do. You know, the university gives you the Moodle, they give you the training. All you need to do is put your lecture notes there, and you have it. Easier said than done. It's not that easy, you know? Because we had to tell ourselves, like, no, we don't come from this era. And we needed to look at things like social networks, and YouTube, and what I had this e-learning 2.0, you know, and our students know a lot more than we did. So in a way, it was a learning curve for all of us as well. And so getting started was not easy. But this year, I think it will be a bit easier because the system is in place, and it's a lot easier for us. Now, the expectation is that it reduces preparation time. You and I know it does not. Because you are the content expert, you are the content manager, you are the one that builds the online community, you are the one that is the so-called computer consultant. You do everything, all right? And it's supposed to be easy, it's not. It's not easy, your preparation time, it takes a lot of preparation. But then that was the same when you had your lectures, right? When you came in as a new lecturer, it took you maybe, I don't know, a whole week to come up with one lecture, but now you can give the same lecture, but you add all different things, and adding on what is current is a lot easier than, you know, coming up from scratch. So it's the same thing. It's the same thing, except that there is a few, there's a learning curve. And the perception is that it improves the efficiency. To me, that's a good mean. All right? Because you have to design your modules. You have to manage things carefully. You have to keep your facilitators from going off track. I mean, how many of us say we want to do a Google search, let's say, on the genetic effects of learning? And then we go there, we see a gene, and then we look at the DNA. But there's also a gene, you know, J-E-A-N. And then you go to Zalora because there's a sale on jeans, you know? And then you go there, they say, I might as well look at shoes. And this is like, from a perspective, maybe handbags, you know? And then, I was really looking at jeans as a female. So they're all that kind of things that take up a lot of our time, take up a lot of our students' time. And there is that danger that if we do something like this, if we give them the freedom, all right, they will go to places like that. But to their credit, and I think to the credit of the lecturers also, we somehow managed to focus. So if it increases efficiency, I would say that's a myth. But so it's just as good as giving the lecture, but in a way it allows us to actually do more at the end of the day. You know? So if you give me a choice, would I go back to my traditional lecture? I would say no, because this is a lot more fun. And it's always good to get your brain to learn something new. And to me, it's learning something new every day, because my favorite aspect about Project Impact was that I was able to learn more about my students than I ever could in a lecture. I taught 200 students. How would I know anyone except the guy who sleeps at the back and the girls in front who are paying attention? And even then, they really look like they're paying attention. To me, the ones who look like they're paying attention are the ones that are sleeping. You know? So, I couldn't, but when it was online, and you know the nature of our children, they would rather send you a Twitter message, SMS. You learn a lot more, at least I learn a lot more from them. I read through, I can participate in discussions. They were a lot more open with me. And we were given a better opportunity to reach out to those with difficulties because they felt they had a one-on-one collaboration, but really it wasn't, right? I had 200 students, but our lecturers found out that we could have an opportunity, to reach out to those with difficulties. In a way, it also helped me change, yeah? Because I think change is important, especially if you've been a lecturer as long as I have, and you have the same lecture year after year, it gets etched in stone, and then you come and say the same old things, and say, don't worry, I'm giving you the basics, the new things, you better read out on your own. You know, it's like that. So, I had to change. I had to change to keep up with the times, and I had to change how I approach the topics. I had to change, otherwise, you know, I'll go the way of dinosaurs. So I have acquired a kind of a different perspective. I have a greater respect for students, how they learn. And I think as much as the students learn from it, I think I learn a lot more from it as well. So in summary, I would say when we did Project Impact, at the core of what we do is a student-centered project. It is problem-based teaching strategy. And what makes the university happy is that it's tied to content standards and learning outcomes. Now, where are we? Now, I showed this last time, sorry, yes?
Can you tell us the major differences
between the students
in the past, maybe in the year?
Say that again? Funds. Okay. All right. The students that came in the beginning, they're all basically the same. We don't know where they have the same standards, right? The ones who took the different paths, that's interesting. We're still looking at it, but in the beginning, everyone chose the first pathway, and our understanding is because they think that you know, otherwise they'll feel exams. And from there, the ones that came up for the research pathway, these are the students that were more open. That could see how interesting this was. They were the ones that were able to string more than two sentences together. The ones that went for research, the ones that went for community, and that's why we had ones for community and core. These were the ones that that had more of what we call our interpersonal and intrapersonal intelligences. These were the ones that that fit the profile. What is important for us here is that we wanted them to choose things that fit with their profile, and hopefully if it didn't fit, that they would still have the different experiences. Of course, there are a lot of holes in what we're doing there. We think that there are things that we need to tighten up, and we're thinking of tightening up this year. The major issue here is to change the perception of ourselves as much as to change the perception of the students. Along the way, we had a lot about competitions. We had crossword puzzle competitions. The first thing we did, we had a competition, I think, where the prize was actually to have lunch with the dean. That didn't go down too well. That was because, you see, I thought it was a good idea. So, and I thought it was a good idea, but not many people joined in that competition. I thought, wow, you know, how often do I have lunch? But we didn't get that much. So I learned from this and I said, what would you want next? You know? So the next one we had was another lunch, but this time they could bring a friend of theirs and they could have lunch together outside. That came up, that was much better. but aren't you the dean? No, I think maybe if you ask me, there's no one. So I hope that answered your question. Yeah, okay. So anyway, that was what we did. And now that I'm coming to the end of it, I want to look at the future of e-learning. I've actually showed this slide a long time back and I gave a talk, but it is something that I feel personally, and I thought I needed to share with you, because it's interesting, yeah, that, but this is Moore's law, by the way, that shows the exponential increase in the use of microprocessors. It says that by 1971, computers had 64 times the power of their predecessors. We had a 64K computer, you know, and then along the way, by 2008, they were 2 billion times more powerful, and then in 2010, 4 billion times more powerful, right? So it's a frightening thing, you know, that they can get all this information so easily and so fast and from somewhere else, and how are we coping up with this? Because if you look by 2030, they will have the same processing power as the human brain itself, right? And if you think about it, yeah, when you have that supercomputer that fits in the palm of your hand, when it's wirelessly connected to a billion others, you will have in your hand a computer. I mean, Prof. Rossi tells me you have this supercomputer that can be put on a tabletop, right? Now you're going to have it in the palm of your hand. And soon it's going to be at the tip of your finger, and then you sneeze, and then you go, oops. There goes the rest of my life. But anyway, you have that. And then you have what's up here. How do you reconcile between what's up here and what's here? You know? Because the question for me is that, how then do I, as being in the university, how do I prepare them for that world? Because I come from a different world. They're going to live in another world, a world that I will not be able to see. So you know, it's a big challenge to be a lecturer, because you are actually preparing them, and this is what Omar Al-Khattab said, you know, a long time back, that you're preparing someone for a world that you will never see. This is a very, very big responsibility. How do we prepare them for something that we will never see in 2020, maybe, and beyond? So really, that is the crux of what I wanted to say and the challenge that we have. And before I end, I would like to invite anyone who has any research that you want to do, please come and join us at the Brain Network Center. We have a name that sounds bigger than where we are, actually. In the Brain Network Center for Neurocognitive Sciences at the School of Health Sciences. We do have a small research cluster grant. We have more than 30 lecturers that are looking at different aspects of the brain. There are various aspects that are still not being looked at. Just now I was talking to, his name, it's in my bag. but he's a quantity surveyor, so shit, Prof. Yes, Aslan, and he actually needed to look at brainwave structures, how color affects it, what kind of a structure can I have in the childcare center that we want to set up in the forest of Belong Temunggo complex, you know. And we actually need people to look at languages. How do people who use the Temia and the Jahai language, how would they differ in terms of their learning? And we're talking to the linguist just now. How do we do this? How can we leave something? Because at the end of the day, I think all of us, we need to leave a legacy. No matter how small it is, we need to leave a legacy of our place on Earth. And I hope that I would really love it if you would come and join us on this journey in helping our students achieve more than we ever could.
Thank you.
consideration. see there is a change in the way they thought. In the early part, the feedback was, can I have a copy of your PowerPoint? Can I have your notes? Okay, but at the end of the day, it changed. Nobody asked us anymore for that, but they actually were saying, can we have more fun like we had this time? So the emphasis there was on having fun, but the sad thing about the students, they actually needed permission to have fun. You know, so that was it. I wonder whether that answered the question. Before, okay, in terms of summative and formative assessments, yeah, the formative assessments were actually more geared towards letting the students know where they stand. Right? So the assessments were there, but it did not come into consideration with the final marks. But the students used that to gauge where they are at the level or where they should be. So we did a lot of that formative assessments, and because it never came into the final marks, so the university allowed us to do it. You know? But we made the students give the questions, and we made the students actually mark that. But if you use Moodle, you can even do assessments feedback that way. And the good thing is, if you have, you have them to answer questions in an essay form, you can actually make sure if it's group work, it's really group work and not one person's work, because they have to log in and give their answers, and in a way that minimizes that as well. Of course, at the end, the project that they did, 10% of the marks went to the final. There were 10% of the marks were given for their access to online learning. So when we told them that in the beginning, we never told them how much they had to access. So we found, interestingly, if you look at the data, everyone accessed the online learning in the beginning, and then almost everyone didn't after that, until we told them we also accessed your quantity and why, and everybody came back and accessed. So people are still very much driven by the assessment process.
Okay, we have time for more questions.
Assalamualaikum, I'm from Melbourne.
stuff, right? But in the book, it says that doing something else might that stimulate the area of the brain enhances that difficulty. So the author, the neuroscientist that did a study on this, and that neuroscientist was 6 years old. He wants to enhance, he wants to understand the way to enhance the capacity of the brain. So, and through studies, he figured out that by having your eye between complex symbols, see, for example, complex languages, stimulate the area of the brain that stimulates different skills, for example, listening, reading, doing social interaction, on the but it affects that. So, he learns new languages every day. Being in the US, American, complex language, looking at his Chinese. So, he learns Chinese language every day. So that from this study that improves that the skills a lot. Now reflect when I read that part also it's amazing, it's amazing. So when I try to reflect on my life and majority of us we are told that we have the opportunity to read complex languages, the Arabic being one of the complex languages. So reading the Quran. So when I reflect on my life, there are parts of my being human being, there are ups and downs, so the same with the frequency of reading for us, so when I reflect on my life, the part when I read for us with a high frequency compared to this lowest frequency, I just see that there's a big difference. For example, confidence level, my reading ability, the absorption of knowledge by reading and writing papers. It grows a lot, even confidence and talking to people is simple. Conversation that has a big difference between when this is my actual reading what I read from the book, but I don't know about my research, so I don't have any basis. I don't know that they have any basis of my extrapolation of that. So I just want to see what your views on this, because I do believe that brain, human brain is designed, to be harmonious with our daily life, so that there are simple practices that we do in daily life that have a big
effect. Another good question. It's kind of difficult to answer, but I agree. That's a very interesting book, The Brain That Changes Itself. And the core of that book, as well as others of that, is the concept of neuroplasticity, how the brain can change itself, and how that change can affect your life positively or otherwise. And I do agree that there are ways there are certain things that you do that will stimulate very specific pathways. And we have the data that shows you that certain things that you do, very simple tasks, will stimulate the pathway between learning and the ability to think, right? And there are 5 of those pathways, that's one. But the other thing that you mentioned, which is a good thing, is that we also, in the process of just stimulating that, we also have to learn around the topic. Meaning that what we do in schools, like my daughter, I've got a daughter who's in Form 1, my youngest, and she actually likes Korean. Anything Korean, right? I don't know, it's a thing right now. And then I thought, okay, she looks at this, the feminine MC, but she actually learns the language. She actually could read and write the language, and she learned it for herself. Right? Is this going to be useful? Perhaps there's no exam on Korean. But what it did is that it builds up a part of your mind that is related to your ability to understand, your ability to use this knowledge for other things. So it is experiential, and that experiential information is very important. What we do is we have a culture of postponement. Okay, don't do it now. You study first, you pass your SPM, and then later you can read those books about Korean. Don't do that now. Then you say, wait till you get into university, and then wait till you get to university, we tell them, no, you pass this exam, wait till you get work. By that time, I think it's too late, because all we know is to get from A to B, but we never see the richness of things around us. And it is that richness, I think, that helps you learn, as you said. We can better learn something if we learn something else, and it is so far away from what we do, because what that is, it stimulates the different pathways. stimulate the first time you hear something, it stimulates this pathway. Then as soon as it stimulates this pathway, everything else is stimulated as well. You know, for example, your ability to learn something. If that learning something was associated with a teacher that you hated, you're never going to be able to learn that, because it goes to the association areas as well. If you pass a shop, for example, where you had diarrhea, the smell of maybe, I don't know, char kway teow, you had diarrhea, maybe you ate char kway teow, it gives you a horrible feeling. You walk somewhere, you have a whiff of perfume, it makes you smile, because maybe that was the first perfume your boyfriend or your girlfriend gave to you. You know, so those associations are very important, I think, in the process of learning. But you're right, those are the things that we miss. Our enthusiasm to make people study and study and study. We miss, as you said, time to smell the flowers. So thank you very much for that insight.
Okay, that was interesting. Any other questions?
So I'm good morning. I'm Lanzina from School of Distance Education. It's interesting that most of the things that you just said and the practice, actually we at the school with the patient has been doing it because of the nature of students different from the normal undergrads. So I'm just sort of curious that what practice are on this what you call critical natives, but we have students of all three groups. We have some critical natives, most digital immigrants, and even digital fugitives, a few. So how is it if you want to implement or just like what you have done, whether it's what you've given them is the right thing or not, like just like what you're doing, but for our own crop of students, is there anything that you think we should do to suit them better rather than this group of, you know, they are all people natives, right? But for us, you know, it's not that easy. So can you advise? Thank you.
Thanks for the question, because I agree with you. Things like multiple intelligence, our Gartner, this has been around forever. All right, things like how the brain learns, brain based education, this is something that has been there forever. All right, and these are things like cognition. Piaget talks about things like this, like, and Piaget is like such a something that is not new. So a lot of the things that we say are not new. Right? They're not new things, and there are things that I think should have been implemented in schools. Right? But when you go to the schools, you do not see any of what is learned is being implemented. You know, unfortunately, we don't see that. So I think if we're talking about issues, one of the issues is that why is it we don't implement what we do? And I think we need to look at that. The other thing is what makes it different, looking at it from this point of view, is that concept of the neuroplasticity. And I think what we have now is the ability to assess. As we said, can we measure? Can we measure these things and how we measure them? The tools for measurement are there, and we do have the tools with us. Because previously, yes, we have tools, but the tools were actually just like the paper-based tools that we gave. They're highly subjective. Yes, there are normative values, but they're highly subjective, and they're neuropsychological assessment tools. We really need an objective kind of assessment that will really give us those issues, but at the same time, we need an objective assessment that will allow us to compare across board, as you said, between those who are the natives and the immigrants and this and across races, racial lines. I want to compare, and for an Asti club one day with a child in a school in Damansara Heights, I want to compare this with someone in Australia. How do I do that? Right? And we're lucky because we live in a time where we do have that instrument that we brought today, the CanTab. What does it stand for? Cambridge, something or other set of a battery of tests. And what the CanTab does is that it is non-cultural. It's not based on what makes it speak. You know, there's no speech involved, and it can be done across different cultures. So we can cover that. It also assesses up to 21 different parameters. What we brought here was the one that was the least, the shortest one, like reflexes, you know, reaction time. what to make this more effective. For us, we're looking at cognition in terms of learning and memory. We're very specific in terms of just learning and memory for the simple reason that we need to narrow our focus. But the field is wide open when it comes to the neurosciences. And if anybody would like to use any of our instruments that we have, you're welcome to it. We have the EEG. We have one that is good. We're going to get one that is mobile that we can bring into the field rather than bringing the child to the center. We have the CAN-TAP and we can discuss and always willing to have this taken up by other champions that can widen the scope. So thank you very much and I hope we can look at some form of collaboration in this area.
Can you speak loud enough?
Today, I'm quite interested in how you assess the learning. There are four types of learning you mentioned just now from your school. Four types of learning, you have e-learning, all this type of learning. But will be the lecture become have to play a role, different role? One become a lecturer, one become a leader in some type of learning, and different type of role. Then will be the lecture become sometimes confused which type of role they have to play. One teacher have only teach them, one student, one become leader when they run a community service, one become an e-learning, then they become instructor, how they conduct the class. And then the lecturer also be confused, which one I want to play actually. Then I think they cannot concentrate what they want to teach, what they want to transfer the knowledge, how about thinking. The second is, specialist, do you run any test on the effect of reinvigorations or any more? What have you knew? Anything similar to us? Any research on it? If you have, can I sign for volunteer for that? That's all. My questions.
Thank you for the questions. In terms of the role of the lecturer, you know, I come from a medical background. A long time back, medicine and even now, it's an apprenticeship. You know, you sit there with, and a long time back, you sit there with the guru or the sifu. Maybe you prepare his food, maybe you sweep his floor, but along the way you learn the values from the teacher and then he will pass on the information to you and then this goes on. And then after some time, you know, there is this need for teaching. At Al-Azhar University, where I went, I didn't study there, I was at Chicago, but I see that they still have this teaching where it goes on in a circle and the teacher sits there as a fountain of knowledge, imparting knowledge. So we could do that, but you know, at this moment, we're not fountains of knowledge, and the knowledge is available already somewhere else. You know, so we don't want to reinvent the wheel. So really, if you ask me, what's my role right now? I would think I would be the facilitator, and we all know that very well. I would be the one I think that needs to point out to my students as to where they can find the knowledge. And again, my role, I think, would be to say, you Google it, and you get what, 1 billion answers, 1 million from that. I think our role would be to work with the student to sift through that knowledge to find out which is the best answer. And I think both students and teachers probably need to learn that the knowledge doesn't reside within my brain, but my brain will help you to look for answers because I have the experience. Not like I tell my PhD students that when they join us initially, you know, they look to me for answers as to whether they have a project that is good enough. And then I told them that along the way, my criteria for being a good supervisor would be at the end of the second or the third year, it would be them telling me what they do, and that they are the ones who have that knowledge more. And that I think, you know, is how you pass on that, because now you have a student that knows more than you do. And to me, that would be the greatest gift, that along the way, I have nurtured someone who has more knowledge than I have now, that can now carry that legacy forward and build more knowledge there. I don't think I would be happy if it is at status quo, that the student knows only as much as I do or even less than I do. So I think, yes, the role of a lecturer is a lot more challenging now. Because anytime you say something wrong, they'll say, but the internet said like this. And you can't go back and say, other people have different points of view. I appreciate that. Now, in terms of wide open. We are looking at the learning and memory. And yes, we even go down to the genetic levels, looking at specific areas in the brain. Of course, we will be friends. You're welcome to come and work with us at the Brain Network Center. We've got rats that are drunk, rats that have not had enough food, rats that are overstressed because we make them swim a lot and they don't like water. We've got all kinds of rats, you're welcome to them. But if you want to be a subject, please give me your email address.